And these five words can be found in the penultimate verse of the Bible. It is commonly described as the last prayer. A very powerful prayer in the Bible that is so fervent, yet so concise and so powerful. Even so, come Lord Jesus. This is the desire of every saint of God that is born again. The truth I have found about the book of Revelation is that the book of Revelation is the revelation of Jesus Christ. John, whilst he was on the Isle of Patmos, ended the canon of scripture exalting the Lord Jesus Christ. And there is no other way to end the word of God except by exalting the Son of the living God. The truth is that this is what the Bible is all about, from the beginning of the Bible all the way through to the book of Revelation. At the beginning of the Bible, we hear the prophets echoing his name through history, telling the world when the Messiah comes, born of a virgin in Bethlehem of Judea. The men and women of that time saw the prophecies that were recorded come to fruition right before their eyes. However, Jesus did not come into existence when these prophecies were fulfilled. Don't ever start your thinking about Jesus Christ in Bethlehem. Don't even start your thinking about Jesus with his conception by the Holy Spirit in the womb of the Virgin Mary. Don't even start your thinking about Jesus Christ in his appearances in the Old Testament, because your view of Christ will be wrong and your Christian life will waver. We must be clear about the origins of Jesus Christ. John 1 verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In other words, in the beginning was Christ, and Christ was with God, and Christ himself also was God.
The final prayer in the Bible. In the last chapter of the final book of the Bible, surely I come quickly with the final words of Christ. These final words are our hope and assurance that he is definitely returning to take the saints home. Surely means most assuredly, undoubtedly. It means that no matter what happens, it is a promise that is guaranteed and won't change. His words are true and unchanging. If he has said it, then it will definitely come to pass. The verse states, surely I come quickly. And you may ask, it has been 2,000 years since Jesus ascended into heaven. How can he become quick? What you and I need to remember is 2 Peter 3:9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. What we should know is that, to the Lord, 1,000 years is a day, and a day is as 1,000 years. In other words, 1,000 years of time could drag by, and it would only be as a day in the sight of the Lord. So we could even say, since the ascension of the Lord Jesus, only 2 days have passed to God, whereas 2,000 have passed here on earth. And when you get this term in the Bible, a little while, it is not used in the context of the human lifespan that flickers for a while like a candle on the earth and is eventually snuffed out after 70, 80 years or so. A little while to the Lord could be 2 days in his time, or 3 days, or 4 days. But one thing we can be sure of is this: history is moving. The clock is ticking. The days are passing. The years are moving towards this wonderful coming. We are all impatient, saying, what, I've been here for 60 years, and he hasn't come back yet. Where's the promise of this coming? We are measuring the Lord's return based on the finite understanding of our human minds. The Bible says, yet in a little while, and the Bible is a spiritual. Therefore, we must not seek to understand spiritual things with an earthly view. The second coming of the Lord is described as the blessed hope. There are several good reasons why the Apostle Paul described the second coming of Jesus Christ as our blessed hope. In Titus chapter 2:13, it is a blessed diagnosis of any illness. No more heartbreak upon hearing the death of a loved one. No more funerals, no more caskets, no more weeping. No more anger or resentment or unforgiveness or lust or greed. No more jealous rivalries, no more rejection, no more disappointment. No more friction between husbands and neighbors, partners and their children. No more suffering. Jesus will surely come unannounced, suddenly, like a thief in the night. This time, not as a lowly lamb to be slaughtered and tortured, but as the King of glory who has come to establish his kingdom and take his beloved home. He will come to end the sufferings of his children. How glorious will it be, how beautiful will it be when we finally meet our Father in heaven. He is definitely coming with his reward and recompense to give to those who have been steadfast and have yearned for his coming and whose heart cries out, "Come, Lord Jesus." Just a perception of heaven will make us yearn even for the quick return of the Lord. The beauty of heaven is mesmerizing. Think of the most beautiful place in this world. Think of the blue islands, the landscape, the serenity of nature, and the aura of peace they exude. Think about how fascinating and perfect they are, but they still don't come close in comparison to the beauty of heaven. The way the Bible describes heaven is so moving, our imagination cannot do heaven justice. If you must miss anything at all, make sure it is not heaven. Apostle John saw a clear vision of what heaven looked like and gave the most beautiful pictorial description of what heaven looks like in the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verse 10 through 27. Here is an excerpt. "And the city lieth four square, and the length is as large as the breadth. And he measured the city with the reed, 12,000 furlongs. The length and the breadth and the height of it are all equal. And he measured the wall thereof, 144 cubits, according to the measure of a man, that is, of the angel. And the building of the wall of it was jasper, and a city of pure gold, like unto clear glass. And the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stones. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third chalcedony, the fourth an emerald, the fifth sardonyx, the sixth sardius, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth a chrysoprase, the 11th a jacinth, the 12th an amethyst." Christ, after all these descriptions, I don't think anyone should miss eternity for any reason. Such beauty, such glory, such detailed description of eternity. Lord, whenever you are ready, we await your glorious arrival. Whatever it is that we entangle ourselves with at the moment that impedes us from looking forward to the arrival of our Lord Jesus, isn't definitely worth going to hell for. This world is not our own. It is but a passing phase, and we are sojourners who will return home one day. Revelation 22:20. "He which testifieth these things saith, Surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus." He is coming quickly to put an end to unending tears and strife. He won't go with everyone, but with those that are similar to those five wise virgins and have prepared themselves adequately for the arrival of the bridegroom. And even unto those whose heart cries, "Come, Lord Jesus." In a world where there is constant distraction, or where doing the will of God daily seems like an impossible task, we need the Holy Spirit to uphold and give us the needed strength to walk our Christian journey. Let us take this prayer of faith. Lord Jesus, we bless you. Thank you for your everlasting love. Thank you because your promises fill our hearts and even make us to hope beyond this ephemeral world. We know that your words are true and that your promises are eternal. We beseech thee, O Lord, that you strengthen our hearts this day and make us to wait on you daily. We ask that you help our hearts so we can yearn for you daily and not get caught up in the affairs of this world. Help us to not get tired or weary. Let us live our lives daily in such a way that Maranatha will be our focus in every passing day. Amen.